acute febrile illness and liver involvement. And when we refer a patient to specialist, what's the specialist definition? Who diagnose a patient without touching? Okay, most of us agree. One of my patient told me, डॉक्टर साहब आप तो बड़े साहब के पास भेज दिया, उन्होंने सब पेपर्स देखा लेकिन टच नहीं किया है. एंड द पीडियाट्रिशियंस एंड क्लिनिशियंस हु डायग्नोस डिफिकल्ट टू डायग्नोस ए पेशेंट विथ रिपीटेड क्लिनिकल एग्जामिनेशन, दैट्स ए क्लिनिशियन. एंड स्पेशलिस्ट दे डायग्नोस विदाउट टचिंग. द रिपोर्ट्स. नाउ कमिंग टू माई टॉपिक, लीव फर्स्ट बिफोर वी गो टू अप्रोच a patient who has a febrile illness and liver involvement. Basics, what's the liver? Liver has four histological structures. One is hepatocytes, biliary tree, blood vessels, and RE cells. The most specific to the liver is only hepatocytes and biliary tree. Rest two, blood vessels and RE cells, are shared by whole system, multiple system, your spleen, heart, everywhere. Okay, coming to functions of the liver, you have different functions, right from bile production to synthesis, including phagocytic functions. Today's topic, febrile illness and liver involvement, acute. The febrile acute phase is from days to weeks, 2 weeks as per clinical definition, and hepatic involvement is more than 6 months is chronic liver disease, less than 6 months is acute. Coming to, as a clinician, I see a patient who has an acute systemic disease with liver involvement and a patient who has a liver disease with systemic progression symptoms. The two types of different patient, but both has both systems involved. But we need to diagnose what is the primary involvement. We can divide these category patients into three types. One is extrahepatic, that means you have a systemic disease with a liver involvement, or you can have a primary liver disease, or you can have a liver disease and then systemic progression further, like you have fulminant hepatic failure and hemophagocytic syndrome, what we have talked, HLH, and hepatorenal shutdown. Coming to extrahepatic, as we say, we have four structures in the liver. Coming to RE cells, what clinical symptoms we get when we have a RE cell involvement? Like, whatever etiology, systemic disease, that is the primary symptoms you see. In a patient who has a systemic disease with RE cell involvement like hepatosplenomegaly, you can have systemic disease symptoms. And that may be, in fact, I'm not going in detail about each condition etiological, and it's infective conditions. You have many infections like typhoid, malaria, leptospirosis, all that can involve multiple system, including liver, and especially RE cells. And inflammatory condition, yes, collagen vascular disorders can involve RE cells, hepatosplenomegaly, not hepatocytes. Infiltrative conditions, can agree there's many like histiocytosis, like leukemias, all can involve RE cells in the liver, not the liver cells. And finally, metabolic and drugs. Drugs, especially corticosteroid, can involve RE cells, not hepatocytes. And we had discussed in our previous lecture, and hepatocyte involvement. Yes, in dengue, we can have a RE cell involvement. You have a mild elevation of liver enzymes. And you can have a hypoperfusion injury in a dengue decompensated shock syndrome. Hypoperfusion injuries, you can see thousands of, like elevation of liver enzymes in thousands. In only if it is a dengue fever, you can have a, in hundreds in SGPT, SGOTs are elevated. Like hypoxia, hypoperfusion, Reye syndrome, and metabolic, like Wilson's. You can have a hepatocyte involvement. The symptoms of hepatocytes, as a clinician, patient comes to us with a loss of appetite, nausea, and vomiting. And coming to biliary tract, what are the symptoms? If this biliary tract compartment is involved in the liver, you have only three symptoms: jaundice, clear color stools, and pruritus. And you can have in different conditions, like TPN, total prolonged TPN patients, starvation, drugs, IBDs, and CMV infection. Coming to the final compartment in extrahepatic is a vascular compartment. You have different etiologies, the presentation either ascites or the vascular compartment is involved, secondary to cardiac conditions. You have a cardiac disease like constrictive pericarditis with liver vascular congestion, and you can have a thrombosis like Bucciari syndrome, and finally, sickle cell disease. Coming to specific hepatic involvement, you have a neonatal and pediatric. In neonatal condition, you have a different types of neonatal hepatitis, different viruses. We are not going to go in detail about etiology. And fetal malignancy is presenting at birth. You have neuroblastomas with metastatic liver disease, metastasis to the lung, neuroblastomas. Those patients can present as neonatal immediate presentation. And coming to childhood, you have a different type of hepatotropic viruses, autoimmune hepatitis, metabolic conditions, drugs and toxins. Yeah, drugs like anti-tuberculosis drug and anti-convulsive drugs can cause hepatocyte involvement. And coming to parasite, liver flukes, schistosomiasis can present as hepatocyte involvement, including even biliary tract. And finally, coming to space-occupying lesions. When we palpate a liver, we were discussing about the spleen. Yes, neonates, nearly 5 to 7% of neonates have a normal spleen palpable, but soft spleen. And pediatric age group up to 12 years, 1 to 3% of the pediatric age group can have a normal spleen palpable, but it's soft. Spleen, that doesn't mean that always is abnormal. Consistency, surface is important before we say it's abnormal spleen. And in neonate, you can have a liver span of almost 4.5 centimeters, and you have a smooth leafy margin, not firm margin. Okay, and the radial lobe can extend directly straight away down into the right iliac fossa. It's a tongue-like projection from the liver. That much radial lobe we can palpate till down to the right iliac fossa. The span goes on increasing. It reaches in childhood by 12 years. It's 8.5 in females and 9.5 in pediatric age group. Smooth, soft, and leafy margin, but soft. If it is firm, then it's something underlying liver disease. Hepatomegaly localized as diffuse. Yeah, if you have a localized disease, you have a localized enlargement of lobar involvement, and diffuse involvement, generalized systemic or generalized diffuse liver primary pathology can involve the liver. Yes, always think, keep in mind when we see a patient, three things: acute, one is onset, duration, and progression. If you find these three, you can reach to almost clinical diagnosis, not the etiological diagnosis, at least anatomical diagnosis. And if you find a patient with acute presentation, firm liver, non-tender, and in a background with a stunted growth, that means you are dealing with something acute presentation in a chronic liver disease. Yes, do all hepatomegalies need LFT? Yes, answer is no. Though if you have a malaria and typhoid, why do you want to do LFT? We need to diagnose etiological. If you have any other systemic disease, we don't need LFT to monitor and diagnose, and plus serial monitoring of LFT if you have mild elevation of liver enzymes. Who needs it? If you have primary liver disease with liver-specific symptoms, you need a LFT and monitor LFT. But not like a systemic disease involving the liver with mild elevation of liver enzyme with no albumin change and no INR, altered INR. Just simply, how to interpret liver functions? What is the clinical interpretation? Okay, it's very simple. If you have SGPT and SGOT, that tells you about acuity and the diffuse liver involvement. For example, if you have a liver abscess, you don't see SGPT, SGOT elevation. It's just an acute and diffuse liver involvement. Okay, and if you have an acute viral hepatitis, for example, you have a diffuse hepatocyte involvement with SGPT, SGOT is involved, but acute lesion with diffuse involvement. That's one. Bilirubin tells you about the extent and the severity of the disease. Extent and the severity of the disease. And GGT and alkaline phosphatase, yes, many, but roughly for clinician is obstruction. And coming to albumin, half-life is 21 days. is a chronicity. That means you should have a liver involvement, acute, chronic, diffuse, more than 3 weeks involvement you need. Otherwise, in an acute condition, we see a low albumin in a background of child who has a already undernourished child who has a low albumin. That is a different. But in normal host, we should have a at least chronicity. That tells you about the chronicity of liver. If albumin is down, that tells you about the chronicity of the liver disease. Prothrombin time, yes, is a good prognostic marker. That tells you about the prognosis. And more specific out of all is only two things. Bilirubin and INR is specific to the liver. Rest other all, SGPT, SGOT is like by system, many system. SGOT, yes, you need to maintain that ratio when liver is involved. And if you have a systemic disease, or like dengue fever, yes, you see a SGPT, SG elevation, mild, but SGOT is more. For example, I'm just, this is an LFT of patient who has SGPT, SGOT in thousands, and bilirubin is direct hyperbilirubinemia, more than 20%. Alkaline phosphatase, albumin is normal, INR is normal. What do you say? It's an acute, diffuse, extensive, non-obstructive liver disease with a good prognosis. That's what clinical interpretation. Next, rest, everything is seen by specialist. Our job is done. This is a simple interpretation of clean LFTs. Now, take-home message is when you have an acute presentation, think beyond acute. If you have an underlying firm liver, think beyond acute. Maybe an underlying chronic liver disease with an acute presentation. If you have a liver involvement, think beyond liver. It may be a systemic disease presenting as a liver, or liver going into complications, fulminant and hemophagocytic syndromes and many other hepatorenal shutdowns. Thank you.